Large language models have gotten so good that by now, virtually everyone agrees that they are going to fundamentally change society. And each new generation of LLMs is bigger and better than the previous. It seems obvious that just by scaling up the size of these models, they will keep getting better and better, and eventually surpass human intelligence. Except that, actually, no, that isn't obvious at all. In fact, the entirety of statistical learning theory, developed over the last 300 years, predicts the exact opposite. Larger models should perform worse than smaller models, not better. This is why, just 5 years ago, nobody would have predicted that LLMs would be this successful. I mean, the foundational technology behind LLMs, that is, autoregressive transform and neural nets, has existed pretty much unchanged since 2017, but back then, nobody bothered to train extremely large models, because, well, the theory predicted that the models would get worse with scale, not better. So then, why was everyone wrong? Well, it all comes down to the concept of overfitting. In machine learning, we train a model to do what we want it to do by giving it a bunch of examples. Suppose you wanted to train a neural net to add two numbers together. You would give it a list of examples of a pair of numbers as input, and the corresponding sum as the desired output. The neural net then learns, that is, it adjusts its weights, until it can successfully map the inputs to the outputs. And ideally, the result of this learning process will be that the neural net somehow manages to set its weights to just the right values so that it effectively performs the algorithm for adding two numbers together, digit by digit. If it does, then great. We can now use this neural net to add any two numbers together. However, another way that the model can solve this task would be to simulate a sort of lookup table, which just lists every single training example and its corresponding output. Remember, the model only cares about making correct predictions for the training examples. Nothing else matters. So, this lookup table is a perfectly valid solution. But of course, this lookup table is a terrible solution because if you apply it to new numbers, which aren't in the training data, you get a completely random output. It's like memorizing all of the answers to a test instead of actually studying and understanding the material. And in fact, most possible configurations of weights that solve the training set will behave like this lookup table, not the algorithm. So if you think of the model as just randomly picking one of the possible solutions, then it will almost always end up learning something like this lookup table. This is known as overfitting. The model memorizes all of the details of the training data, but fails to learn the underlying mechanism or rule behind the data, so it can't generalize to new situations. One way to prevent overfitting is to reduce the size of the neural net, so that it simply does not have enough capacity to memorize all of the training examples. In order for a neural net to simulate a lookup table, it needs to somehow encode all of the information in the training data into its weights. If there's 100,000 training examples, all of that information needs to be in the weights, somewhere. But if there aren't enough weights, then it's simply impossible to store all that information. But even a very small neural net can still implement the algorithm for addition. After all, it only takes about 5 lines of code, regardless of how many training examples there are. So if we choose the size of the neural net just right, then the only solution that it can implement will be the correct one, and it will be forced to learn that. And then the model will be able to generalize to new inputs. And this is a very general phenomenon. Almost always, the underlying rule or mechanism behind the data is going to be the smallest way of representing that data. So choosing the model's capacity to be just large enough to accurately fit the training data, but no larger, should be the best strategy to produce models which generalize well. And this is exactly what we observe in practice. Here are the results you get training neural nets of varying sizes on an image classification dataset. As you can see, the test error, that is the error rate when evaluated on new inputs, not in the training data, decreases as the neural net is made bigger up to this point. But then it begins to go up again when the size is increased further. It's at this point that the neural net has just enough capacity to learn the mechanisms behind the data, and adding more capacity just results in memorization. The very largest neural net actually achieves zero training error. It perfectly memorizes the entire training set, but it's not the best model. The model with the lowest test error is this one in the middle. This is why, if you were to ask an AI researcher 5 years ago, "Do you think training gigantic neural nets with trillions of parameters on internet text is a good idea?" they would have said no. It's just going to overfit. Sure, it'll learn the training dataset, but it will just be a stochastic parrot repeating things that it's memorized. It won't have any real understanding. Nobody was thinking about scaling up models because it didn't work. Instead, AI researchers were all trying to come up with better learning algorithms and better neural net architectures to improve model performance. The designing of these algorithmic improvements is an intensely creative process, and there was no way to brute force a solution with more compute. But this would all change in 2019, when a new paper came out demonstrating something very interesting. In this paper, the authors again trained various neural nets of different sizes. But this time, they didn't stop when the neural net achieved zero training error. They kept increasing the size even further. And what they found was, after the neural net could perfectly memorize the training data, the test error actually started to decrease again. And it kept decreasing. In fact, it went even lower than the previously best performing neural net. And it just kept going lower for all of the sizes they tested. They dubbed this phenomenon double descent. As you increase the size of a neural net past the point of overfitting, the test error begins to descend a second time. And this time, it's seemingly without limit. This result came as quite a big surprise. It seemed to open up a new avenue for improving AI. Just keep making the models bigger. But at the same time, this result flies in the face of all known statistical learning theory. It shouldn't be possible for models large enough to memorize the training data many times over to have real understanding that generalizes. So what's going on? Why do larger models generalize better? Around the same time, another paper came out which demonstrated that most of the weights in a large neural net are useless. The authors of this paper found a way to remove up to 96% of the weights from a large neural net without affecting its test error at all. The process they used was as follows. To start with, all weights are initialized to small random values, as usual, and the network is fully trained on the training data. They then removed the 10% of weights with values closest to zero. The reasoning here is that if a weight has a value of zero, then it doesn't do anything. So weights close to zero should be the ones which contribute the least amount. The remaining weights are reset to the same initial values they had before training started. This whole process is then repeated around 30 times. At the final iteration, they had a network just 4% the size of the original, which, when trained from its initial random weights, achieved the same test error as the full network. This finding hints at what's really going on. Hidden inside of a large neural net is a much smaller subnetwork that is actually doing all of the work. The rest is just useless fluff. That's why it can generalize. But why does it generalize better than a small network of the same size as the subnetwork? Remember, normally when you train a smaller network, it performs worse. But that's when the networks are trained from initially random values. The only thing that's different about this subnetwork is the initial values it starts with before training. To understand what's going on here, you need to know a bit about the way that neural nets are trained. Gradient descent. The gist of it is that for each training example, you make a small change to every weight in order to make the net's output closer to the label. We like to visualize this process as a ball rolling down a hill. The hill is the graph of the function which maps possible weight configurations to training error. So each point on this graph is showing you, if you set the weights of the network to some specific combination of values, what the training error would then be. The ball represents the current configuration of weights, and it's initially placed at a completely random point. The goal is to move the ball to the lowest point on the landscape. That corresponds to the weights with the lowest training error. Gradient descent moves the ball just like an actual ball rolling due to gravity, in the direction of steepest descent. The problem with this method is that you can get stuck in suboptimal configurations. In such a configuration, making any small change to the weights results in more error, so the weights just stop changing. There are better configurations for the weights with lower error, but gradient descent will never find them. Because of this, depending on the initial weights you start with, you can end up with different final training errors. A neural net may end up at zero training error with some initializations, but might get stuck early when started from others. For large neural nets, it's really easy to fit the training data, so you end up with zero training error no matter where you start. However, for smaller networks, the initialization becomes crucial, as more possible initializations result in suboptimal performances. For small enough networks, the vast majority of initializations result in suboptimal performance. Some initializations may still result in zero training error, but it's astronomically unlikely to start there when picking at random. Now, inside of a large neural net, there are lots of small subnetworks, which are just big enough to fit the training data, but only if they have a really lucky initialization. Every subset of weights can be thought of as a small neural net, each with a different random initialization. The authors of the pruning paper claim that when you train a large neural net, the result is the same as training all of these different small subnetworks independently, and keeping only the best one while discarding the rest. Most of these subnetworks will have bad initializations and will be unable to learn, but as long as one of them has a lucky initialization, it will go on to solve the training task all by itself. When the authors performed their pruning procedure, they were essentially uncovering the subnetwork with the best initialization. The authors call this the lottery ticket hypothesis. Each subnetwork is like a lottery ticket. It's incredibly unlikely that it will have a good initialization, but when you have billions of tickets to choose from, winning the lottery becomes a certainty. And the number of tickets, equivalent to the number of subnetworks in the full network, grows exponentially in the size of the full network. Training a larger network means more initializations to choose from, but with more initializations to choose from, even smaller subnetworks will be able to reliably fit the data. Remember, the smaller a network is, the rarer it is for it to have a good initialization, and the more tickets you need for it to reliably win. So by making the network larger, you get more tickets, allowing even smaller subnetworks to win. Putting all of this together, we have the very counterintuitive result that the larger you make a neural net, the smaller the winning subnetwork will be, and thus the simpler the learned model. This is why larger neural nets generalize better. Phew, statistical learning theory is saved. The simplest model really is the best generalizer. And it's a good thing too, because it's not just machine learning. All of science is built on this same idea too, though scientists call it Occam's razor. But this really is a miraculous result. Almost by complete accident, we stumbled across a learning algorithm that gets better simply by dumping more computing power into it. No longer do we need to rely on human researchers to come up with clever ideas to push the frontier of AI forward. Now, we can just scale. I would like to point out that as of now, no one knows for sure why training a large neural net behaves like training all of its subnetworks in parallel and selecting the best. It definitely isn't obvious that this should be the case, but one working hypothesis is that the better initializations, the ones which lead to lower training error, also lead to faster learning. That is, they will fit the data with fewer steps of gradient descent. So the subnetwork with the best initialization learns to solve the task first before the other subnetworks have a chance to learn anything. I would also like to point out that the pruning strategy used in the lottery ticket hypothesis paper is nowhere near optimal. Choosing the smallest weights at each iteration is not guaranteed to result in the smallest possible network at the end of multiple iterations. So the 4% identified in the lottery ticket hypothesis paper is an upper bound on the true size of the minimal subnetwork that is doing all of the work. The true size, I suspect, is much smaller than that. So what does all this mean for the future of AI? Right now, there is a lot of debate about whether making better language models will ever result in human-level intelligence. Prominent AI researcher and Turing Award recipient Jan LeCun has made the argument that it isn't possible for language models to learn models of the world. He argues that humans don't bother to explicitly communicate shared common sense knowledge about the world, and so this information isn't present in the internet text used to train language models. But it isn't that simple. Remember, the whole point of a good learning algorithm is that it doesn't just fit the training data. It learns the mechanisms behind the data so that it can generalize. And it does this by finding a small and simple model of the data. So what happens when we apply this idea to language modeling? Well, the smallest program that generates all of the text on the internet is going to be something like a physics engine that simulates all of the particle interactions inside a human brain. It only takes about a few thousand lines of code to specify all of quantum mechanics plus initial configurations for a human brain. So, in principle, a perfect learning algorithm, when trained to predict the next word in internet text, should learn to implement that program. And that program would definitely possess a world model and have common sense understanding and do everything that a human can do. I mean, it's literally simulating a human brain. Now, to be clear, neural nets are nowhere near as good as this ideal, perfect learning algorithm, and the world models they induce are nowhere near human level. But it is certainly clear that modern LLMs do possess models of the world that allow them to generalize beyond their training data, to some extent. And we know that as neural nets are scaled up, they get better at finding smaller and smaller models for their data. So there is a very real argument to be made that just by scaling up LLMs, they will approach this ideal learner, and hence human-level intelligence. I mean, there's a reason why every large company and government in the world is pumping billions of dollars into scaling LLMs. Now, personally, I don't believe that scaling up neural nets alone will be enough to get us to human-level intelligence, and the reason is just that the rate of improvement is way too slow. Yes, neural nets get better when they are scaled up, but it's taking way too much compute to get relatively modest gains in ability. But I do think that language modeling alone is enough to produce human-level intelligence. Even if scaling neural nets eventually reaches a plateau, I see no reason why better learning algorithms, perhaps using entirely different architectures, or maybe neural nets combined with external tools, wouldn't induce human-level intelligence when trained to predict the next word in internet text. In fact, if the learning algorithm is good enough, it's virtually guaranteed to.